Welcome to the ACG interview series. I have fixed the audio, so none of you can hold that against me. And not only have I fixed the audio, I've fixed the interviewees. Now I've got Vanguard. How are you doing, Vanguard?
Great. How are you doing?
I am doing good. I just noticed, I don't normally do this, but I did do some background digging on you. And it turns out you joined a month before me back in 2015. Fucking hell. Oh. I've sworn now.
Really? If you asked me, I would have said that you were in probably a year before me.
No. Yeah, you joined in August of 2015, and I joined literally the exact month later. You joined on the 16th of August, I think it was, and I joined on September the 16th.
Wow.
Yeah.
You know, I don't think that was that long ago, but then doing the math, that's quite a long time ago.
That's pretty mental. So, yeah, what's happened there then? Like, where did you start? Where are you now? I think you started on the Luftwaffe side, right? And you've pretty much always been there, but you've kind of migrated over.
No, it was the other way around. I started 6:10. Yep. I actually still quite vividly remember my first mission. But yeah, I started in 6:10, flew on Tyrone's wing. Had a great time, and I transferred to Luftwaffe in, I think, about 6 months later.
And what was the preamble to ACG? Did you start in... I know your age is even on there as well, but I'm not going to reveal that. Bloody hell, you nipper. Where did you start at Flight Sims?
So, I honestly didn't really get serious with Flight Sims until probably about 2014, about a year before I joined ACG.
Why?
I guess it came down to my main interest.
Okay, what were you
has
doing
been,
before then? What were you FPSing or something? Or not even. What were you?
My whole childhood was Age of Empires, pretty much. Because that was what my dad played. Otherwise, like, my dad, he had ILT 1946, and that's where I guess, best contact. But I, as a kid, I never really interested to be that much. But it was in kind of the back of my head. And then about, 2014, I was thinking, I'm going to, read up on aircraft a bit and whatnot. And then got out 1946, gave it a go, really liked it. Flew on like hyper lobby. This was back when I flew on controller as well. And then when I realized, okay, I actually really like this, I'll get a joystick. Did face track no IR before going to track IR for a bit.
Wow.
And then, I joined ACG about a year after I started doing flight sims.
Was that the usual beginning of the end, or was it just chance to cross it?
Do you mean what campaign we're up to?
How you found ACG?
It was the beginning of the end of the video. I honestly knew nothing about the Battle of Britain, and I thought, wow, this is a really neat way to, one, improve my own flying, because I was pretty bad back then, and good opportunity to learn about the history and sort of the culture around our historical flight simming.
And so you joined 6:10, and then what made you make the leap to the Luftwaffe?
You can definitely blame Luftasher, interview number two, for that. I guess it was quite coincidental that I think at that point, there were only three Australians in ACG, myself, Asher, and Kildren. And Asher happened to live in the same city as I do, and actually not too far away. And we met up to go to an air show. The weather was absolute dog shit, and none of the flying happened, but, we got to chat and meet each other in person. And he did a bit of ribbing and nudging and saying, he's got a great group of boys. And it really just came down to a bit of time zone and playability.
So what I don't get is, why is there not an ACG in Australia? Why is there not an ACG in Germany, an ACG in Spain? Why is it, like, particularly in Australia, right? Given you're in APAC, Asia Pacific, why is there not one there where people are reenacting World War II? Or what is it that's specific to Europe that does this? Is it because we're so ingrained in World War II, like you say, you didn't really know much about Bob and all that? Is that what it is?
To some degree, I think. I think the other thing is logistics. I did actually look around for an Australian flight sim group before I actually came to ACG. And it basically just came down to there's not that much interest, and the people that do have interest are very few and far between. And you're looking at like the maximum organized groups we were looking at were, you know, six people. So if you're really looking to do something on the scale of what ACG does, there needs to be the interest, the amount of people coming together, and just setting up what we do takes a lot of effort and time. So to make it worth, I guess, Europe kind of just centralizes a lot of time zones and makes it the ideal place.
Yeah, but it's just like you're saying, there's not a lot of interest there though either, right? So there's not a lot of people that are interested in sort of World War II stuff in APAC?
Yeah, not so much. The Australian mindset is more actually related to our army in World War One. World War Two and aviation is kind of like off to the side. Even myself, like I got into, my interest is actually more on the naval side, and then reading about naval stuff got into naval aviation, and that transferred into just general aviation.
So it sounds like you started off with basically a keyboard and nothing much more, and now what kind of setup do you have?
At the moment, it's Track IR and a Thrustmaster T16 quadrillion. How many zeros you want to add on the end of that?
Yeah, everyone says that's a really good setup though, right?
Yeah, it served me well.
Does that have force feedback? I don't think it does, right?
No, it doesn't. But it's got good resistance. I had to learn to, like, the muscle memory of it took a while. Even Track IR, it's like the neck muscles getting where you needed to point your head.
And so you've ended up back on the VVS side, or actually now going into Brooke RAF. So, and you're the CO of the squadron. So how did that come about?
So when I transferred to the Luftwaffe, it was about the time when I started getting the first 6 months. I was definitely on a really steep learning curve, where it was going from learning the mechanics of how to fly in a flight sim to actually looking at the bigger picture of teamwork, you know, how to organize, how to, I guess, lead to some degree. And when I came over to fourth staff with Luftwaffe, I was really eager in how to implement like wingman tactics, flight tactics, that kind of stuff. Yeah. And I guess Asher saw the eagerness that I was showing, and put me immediately pretty much into a flight lead position. And we had a really good synergy, I think, going on. And quite soon I became his 2IC, and then he unfortunately had to leave, I kind of took over the administration of the squadron.
I remember listening to you in Battle of Britain, and many times I've listened to you on GC, and you always seem very in control and calm about the whole situation, even when the shit's going down. Is that something that's inherent in you, or is that only during flying that you're in that way?
So I think my personality, I do consciously try to like keep calm and not be almost be like professional about how I hold myself in a campaign situation. I think the bottom line I try to go by is I want to be as objective with my decisions, and I can only do that if I don't let my emotions get in the way.
The cold, hard, steely pilot version.
Yeah.
And look, so surprisingly, so as I said, you're a spring chicken when you look at if your age is correct on the forums. Given that you're a bit of a spring chicken, you're still a veteran of ACG. I'm pretty surprised that I am, because like you, I'm, you know, it doesn't feel like I've been here for like 2 or 3 years, to be honest. Like 2015's, Jesus, I didn't even, was that a real year? What's the lows and the highs of ACG for you in that time? Like, what have you enjoyed? What's worked for you? What hasn't worked for you? Yeah, just take us through that.
Yeah, I agree. The So what Patty's saying, for those who don't know, I'm in my mid-20s, so if I joined in 2015, it would join in like my very late teens, I think it was. But anyway, so ACG to me, it was for when I joined, it was a very different to what I guess people my age was looking for. It's much more mature, and there's a sense of the sense of community around it was very different to what I've known in the internet and any kind of online group.
In what way, though?
It always drove a sense of, I think, belonging and everyone trying to work towards a goal of this historical reenactment without any, you know, competitiveness and no real desire to one-up each other. That's what I immediately felt from what the guys at 610 you know, showed me as to what ACG really meant.
Yeah.
And I think that was the core of what really made me enjoy the place. Because when I joined, I was a terrible pilot. But I never felt pressured. I never felt like, man, I really need to you know, increase my skill or whatever. It was always a case of enjoy yourself, find a way to reflect on the history and just, yeah, go as you will. You know, some people that they take it more seriously, and everyone like treats their flying slightly differently, but it's great that, you know, it's completely open and free. And I'd say like probably one of the things I reflect back on most with most satisfaction is how much I've improved, and not just personally, but as a group with other people. I certainly couldn't have done it just by myself. And I think Wombat, I'd probably have to give the most credit, because he was the one where I think we kind of built on each other, just constantly improving each other to the point where I am now.
Right, so was he your wingman, or did you serve as his wingman, or how did that work? Or did you make him lead for a section?
So to be honest, I have absolutely no idea how we started flying together or how we even became friends. Because I was in the Luftwaffe. He was in 32 Squadron, right?
Yeah.
And flying Hurricanes. So, you know, we were meant to be shooting each other up on the Sundays. But we ended up flying together a lot. I think we flew mainly 109s initially on Box, but then we ended up transitioning to Focke-Wulfs. And that was our bread and butter plane where... And it was nice because the Focke-Wulf is a plane which requires a very close-knit and synergetic teamwork. And that built a lot of my mentality and how I look at air combat.
So go back to the question, the highs and the lows of ACG for you over this period. It's a good long period. I can't believe it. You know, what for you hasn't worked so well, what for you has worked so well? Or however you see, when you look back over that period, what do you see as that experience?
I guess I gave my high. Lows, it's honestly hard to say, but I guess there were periods of... There weren't difficulty, but I guess frustration with it kind of bounced off Asher as well, because we met up more, you know, went to air shows, showed me a bunch of his wargaming hobbies and stuff like that. And at that time, he was running the Moscow campaign, and it was, you know, it was really, running a campaign is really difficult.
Insane, yeah.
And just, so I kind of like, I realized that with him running the campaign, I really had to step up and, you know, start doing squadron work and helping lead the squadron. And it was, I guess the difficult part of that was, it was again another learning curve, taking responsibility for other people and stuff like that.
So one of the things that strikes me about being Australian, you know, you guys have to get up at crack of sparrows generally to fly in the campaign, and I personally don't think I could do that. It doesn't matter how, you know, I'd probably just stick to single player or something. So how is it that you guys actually manage to do that? what, especially over, you know, since 2015, you've been getting up at Cracker Sparrows to fly in the campaign. And, you know, at times some of you got jobs as well, and I'm sure you have had a job since you were a teenager. So how do you keep doing that week in, week out and maintaining it? Because, I mean, I find it pretty tricky just doing it on a Sunday evening, to be fair, with a family that I have to deal with. What is it that really grabs you guys? Like you're saying, you used to do Age of Empires. Has this really got you by the balls that you just feel compelled to just attend? It doesn't matter what time of day it is.
Yeah, for sure. I guess the main point that ACG taught me to be able to do this is, I guess, working different sleep schedules. I can basically work on 4-hour blocks. As long as I get that twice in a day, it doesn't matter too much when I get it in. And I guess that's a benefit of being relatively young and when I started at a very flexible university schedule. So I on Mondays, which is Monday mornings when we actually fly.
Yeah.
Everything was pushed in late afternoon. I even had some evening classes. And then outside of that, you know, there's not actually that many commitments that are necessary. And I mean, at the moment, I'm still working at the university, and the hours with the last year and a half or so with COVID, it's mainly working. I've been doing a lot of like online tutoring, that kind of stuff. So it's a lot of online work. Mm. So hours being flexible for me, obviously Asher, his hours haven't allowed him to. So I count myself fortunate, and I'll just keep enjoying it as I can keep doing it.
When I was looking at your profile, I noticed that, you know, given that we've been a month apart in terms of attendance, or since we joined, in terms of posts, you've done 780 throughout your period here, and I've done 1,347, so considerably more. And I've always noticed that about you, that you seem quite level-headed and reserved in terms of your attitude to ACG and putting your opinion out. You tend to be, I mean, I've always thought of myself as only speaking when needed to, but the evidence doesn't show that. But you definitely don't seem to speak unless you've got something really to say. Is that a fair thing to say about you?
Partially. I think it's also because if I feel like something is serious enough, I want to do it in person, either by, you know, meeting up on TeamSpeak or in PMs. My PM box is probably overflowing. But yeah, I do try to like proofread, and I've written posts in the past and then read the few paragraphs I've written and delete it all. Because there's a sense of, you know, it's the internet, it's written, and I don't want to regret anything that I put on the internet, essentially.
And do you think sometimes people are a bit too quick to hit post rather than just sit back and think?
Yeah, for sure. And I was conscious that, you know, as a young person, you're going to make mistakes, and down the line, as your personality changes, as your views change, you don't really want to have something that you can get pulled back and say, "Oi, what was this about?" You know. And I think it helped with my, not in the long term, I think it's paid off.
And in terms of campaigns, where have you found your feet best? Did you enjoy the Eastern Front? Or do you lament BOB? Are you looking forward to Brook? How does it pan out for you? Or would, you know, are you actually yearning for that naval campaign where you can take off from carriers and laugh at people landing badly? And is that what would do it for you?
Yeah, for sure. I'm always itching for a naval campaign. I think I'd actually take more satisfaction in like helping people understand and get into the naval aviation side of things, because I think it's absolutely fascinating. And partly why I do a lot of DCS, actually. But anyway, let's not go down that road now.
Oh, I'm going to get onto that road. But,
okay.
So, would you contemplate 1946?
Oh yeah, I mean that's where I actually started flight simming, so it's never been a case of, you know, I've never been allergic to it. Yeah, in some way, some people are.
Given the state of the game now, would you be happy to step back? So I had an interesting chat, and I don't know, and I assume people listen to it. I had an interesting chat with Kildren in the interview series, and you know, he said quite rightly, "Well, look, I'll do anything as long as it's entertaining and it's fun, and I don't really give a squiff about the graphics or, you know, the gameplay and the camaraderie is the thing that counts." So he'd happily do 46. He'd happily do anything that works, really. Which, you know, a lot of it goes on in your head. People go on about the graphics and all this. I mean, really, the flight model counts, but the graphics don't count so much because a lot of it's in your head. So would you be happy to go at this stage if someone said, after Tobruk, we're going to do 1946 and we're going to do a Pacific campaign? Would that be right up your alley?
Yes, but no. And I'll clarify, and it's quite irrational, to be honest. I'm not a big fan of the carrier physics in 46, and to be honest, I don't think any flight sim really has done due justice to carrier ops. And I feel like if I really want ACG to do something, take a dive into naval aviation, looking at naval aviation, I want it to be something that I feel is genuine and actually represents how they should be done.
What's genuine then?
It mainly revolves around the operational difficulties around carrier warfare and whatnot, in terms of logistics of, you know, setting up planes on a deck, to how do you recover them, how do you have to hold them in pattern, the structural limits. That's one of the big things I don't think any flight sim really has done well. So as an aviator, it puts a lot of handicaps on you, essentially, that you have to overcome with skill and planning. And I feel like I want a simulator which can really give you the sense of that to truly represent it.
Oh, so I'm glad you said that. So that brings me on to something that is a good discussion point. Skill and planning. Now, we're catering for lots of different people in ACG or any group that attempts to do this kind of thing. So there's some people that just want to turn up and fly. So you could have the argument that, you know, you just have a bunch of almost unlimited carriers, or the ability to just launch within seconds apart, you know, vum, 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 and everyone's up in the air and flying. None of this, oh, you guys are going to have to circle whilst we get up, and we're, you know, there's going to be a gap of 2 minutes or whatever it might be. What's your feeling on that then? Do you prefer to go for the realism side of things as opposed to just get up and fly and have a blast?
Yeah, I think the more I read and the more I understand, you know, what pilots experienced and whatnot, the more I want to try to replicate that as much as we can. Obviously, yeah, there are some logistical restrictions that we have to abide to. And especially, I don't want us to be projected as having a brick wall of, you know, you need to basically take a flight course to get in. And that's absolutely not viable. And so to that degree, it's always this like fluctuating middle ground that we're trying to hit. There's, you know, even in my own opinion, sometimes I think, man, I really wish we could do this more realistically. And another side is like, hang on, is this actually what we should be doing in the grander scheme of things? And I can't give you a solid answer on you know, where I stand, because it will change here and there. But I think I lean towards the realism a bit more.
This goes back to my interview with Dickie, where I said my dream is to have this all-dayer on a Saturday, where you have like an ongoing battle that players have to commit to, because I want to have that effect where players are flying, you know, multiple times a day and actually getting tired doing it, and that affects their performance, and the battle's ongoing and changes as we go forward. Thinking about DCS, because I know you fly the F-14, right?
Right, yeah. I've actually I do the 18, the 14, the 16 to some degree, and my in my heart the F15 is my favorite one, but that's oh, not quite say. As detailed. I don't say.
It's coming, baby. And what about DCS? Like especially for carry ops, given you're a fan of the naval stuff. So does that really float your boat?
Yeah, absolutely. Again, one that's to blame. He got me into DCS modern jets. Up to that point, I wasn't that interested in it. But so I guess the Hornet was the one I started on. And it was just a case of the more I got into it, the more I was like, wow, this is really intriguing. And I mean, I studied engineering, and like looking at these planes, the absolute masterpieces of what you can do. And I think DCS really, in essence, it gives you it doesn't do everything perfectly. I don't think any sim can, because ultimately we're sitting in front of a screen and it's all virtual, but it brings you as close to that experience as possible. And that's what I really like about it.
And so it's no secret, I've got a massive boner for DCS, but for anybody that's flying Cliffs of Dover or Box, what would you say to them about DCS in terms of the leap from those two to DCS? Besides the price.
Yeah, price aside, I think you need to go in with a mindset that you want to be serious about aircraft. There is a certain amount of effort that you do need to put into understand how the aircraft works, so you can actually, at least if you want to be good at it, then to actually, you know, yeah, fly the planes as they're meant to be flown. And granted, you can always you can turn the settings down, you can do a lot of other things to basically just go and shoot some stuff up, but I think at the core it's the flight dynamics which really sets it apart from Box and Cliffs.
And if ACG could have the perfect battlefield, would it be Box, would it be DCS, would it be Claude / De Bruyck?
So again, that goes back to the thing we just talked about before, where I would absolutely love if we could do modern carrier ops jets, but I don't think that's in what ACG really does, in the sense that to really enjoy it, the amount of learning and training you would have to do, it's a bit out of our culture, I would say.
Okay, so within turboprops or props, which arena would you pick and which flight sim?
It might be a bit of nostalgia, but I feel like the Battle of Britain was was the pinnacle of what ACG did. It's not just the sim. I think the Battle of Britain is one of those classic scenarios where it's the purest form of air combat where both sides are relatively equal. Both sides have operational challenges that they each had to face, and each had advantages here and there. But it was the purest form where two air forces were going at it. There's a lot of history. There's a lot of anecdotal evidence and a lot of personal experience, I guess, where people can really reflect on. And I guess to the British people in the psyche, it's one of the most important pieces in their own history. So it's definitely one of those situations where it did get repetitive, but I think it is also one of the most magical pieces of combat aviation history that we actually did look at doing, what that we did for a long time.
Yeah, it's quite mythical for the rest of us. I mean, a lot of us were brought up on it, so it is your kind of, you don't really have it anywhere else, but it's sort of Arthurian, King Arthurian. For us, it's the thing we brought up on, and is the legend that we look to, which resonates for us. And although everything that I really enjoyed the Eastern Front, but there's something about the Battle of Britain that is quite magical, and the fact that you don't really have to go far. But I would change a lot of it myself. I felt a lot of it was contrived at the time, and I would prefer to be scrambled and and make things a bit more twitchy rather than preempted, right? Because it felt like not every raid was intercepted, put it that way.
Another thing, just generally across all sims, I don't think any flight sim really does infantry well. And for fronts such as the Eastern Front, or even like if we're looking at Western Desert Tobruk, Normandy, a lot of these interactions between, you know, how air forces operated in those theaters, there was a lot of the experiences that you read about pilots going through is a lot of interaction with the ground, and something which I don't think flight sims represent that well, which is where I think the Battle of Britain is it's unique in that it's purely air forces. And I think that's one of the things that I think really worked well for us.
So if we get to Normandy and we get to, I don't know, the collapse of Germany or Nazism, and then where do we go? What do we do after that? I mean, where's your interest going to be kept for ACG? Are you just going to rinse and repeat for the whole thing again? Or are you going to get to a point where you go, well, I've done it, I've been there, I've done that, and there's nothing else in this for me? Unless the Pacific comes up, which isn't because no one's developing it, then I'm kind of done. Or is this something that will, you know, until you get married with wife and kids and she's going, stop playing those bloody games, you're a man. You know, is that the point that you'll go, I'll have to give it up for a bit?
I've never had a loyalty to a theatre or anything. In this case, I guess I'm more like Kildren, where the group is, I guess, the core, whether it be just my squadron or it's my faction or ACG as a whole. I think wherever we go, we can make it work as long as there's the will and there's the right attitude going into it. To what we were just speaking to before, like I wouldn't mind going back and doing another Battle of Britain. The repetition doesn't faze me.
Yeah, I'm really interested myself because I've thought about it a lot, and I wonder if some of the old guard go, oh no, not again. But some of the new boys are going, oh yeah, let's have a go. And then you think, well, it's Clod, like, or Blitz. Like, do people then go, oh, fucking hell, oh, no, look at that, oh, I can't do that. But then maybe Tobruk will be a bit of an eye-opener and people go, well, yeah, maybe I could do Battle of Britain again. I don't know. We'll see. It's kind of preempted to say or to ask, what would your ideal scenario be? But I guess you're going to say it's the Pacific.
Yeah, outside of the Bob, something Guadalcanal related is probably the most practical and doable. For what we do ACG wise,
any maybe engagement?
Quite frankly, I don't think any of the carrier engagements are actually is actually good for what ACG does, because the ranges involved is just ridiculous. Just put into perspective, I think the strikes flown at Midway, they were flying 150 nautical miles, and the plane's cruise speeds are about 140 nautical miles. So if you do the math,
yeah.
That's a lot of, I guess, a lot of time for chit chat, but not a lot of time for actually, you know, doing the attacking. Or if you go all that distance to, you know, eat a 25mm cannon, if you're on the American perspective. Or...
It's you see, I always struggle with that. It's a tough one because you think, yeah, but that's what they went through. And if we're trying to reenact what they went through, that's what they went through. And you would fly that far, and you either eat lead, you jump, and you land in the sea.
I'd absolutely be for it, but just going by some of the feedback that I saw and discussed with Asher during Moscow, I'm not sure ACG is really cut out for that type of flying, let alone the server numbers that we're restricted to in the current flight sims. Like, it would really mess with our scheduling of how many squadrons and whatnot.
Maybe we could compress it a bit and just reduce the flight times or something.
Yeah, but otherwise, I think Guadalcanal is the best you can do for the Pacific.
What aircraft would be your choice?
I mean, infamously, I think everyone in ACG knows that I'm a massive Corsair fan. And that's understating it a bit, probably, but that's a bit later. That's like 43s. But honestly, I like the theatre. I like the. I like it enough where I can fly anything and not be too bothered.
So, classic Smash Hits question, which is favorite plane of all time?
Corso.
It is.
There's like no question. I'm just looking across my room and there's a framed like black and white sketch of a Corsair. It's like there's no subtlety about it.
What got you? Because you didn't you say your dad? He had 46, but your dad's not. Is your dad a pilot, or he's just interested in aircraft? Or
no?
But you were Age of Empires.
Yeah, like it's nothing related to my background. It's more my fascinations, I guess, is as I studied as an engineer. There's an element of that that's always going through my mind. And one thing that's common across naval aviation 100% is that they're handicapped. Any plane designed for aircraft carrier operations need to sacrifice something to achieve that. And so whenever there's a naval aircraft which can equal their contemporaries, the land-based contemporaries in performance in any regard, I always find that it's not a miracle per se, but it's very impressive from an engineering perspective. And the Corsair is one of those planes. I think there's only two planes really in naval aviation history which would fit that bill. The F4 Phantom.
Oh, I love the Phantom. I always find the Phantom looks futuristic. Every time I look at it, it looks to me like next gen. I don't know what it is. It's that sort of angular.
There's no two ways. You either absolutely hate it or you think it's bizarrely awesome.
I've just always loved it. And so my son's just turned 4 and he's got this book. I'm going to ping it into the forums, actually, because I think it's really quite a cute book for anybody that's interested in aircraft at a young age. And he opened the book on the Phantom. And I was like, oh, that's the Phantom. That's amazing. And I looked at it. I was just like, oh. It does it for me every time. I don't know why.
You like the big burly muscles and the flexed up wing.
It's the angularism, the tail, the nose. It's just there's something about it. It's very different. And I remember when I was young, it just grabbed me. I don't know why, and it still does to this day. It's one of those. I mean, I have a plethora of planes that I like, but that's one that really stands out.
Yeah, I can't blame you. It's a pretty amazing plane.
And so, the classic question, blonde, brunette, or redhead?
Blonde.
Bloody blonde.
It's a bit vanilla, but
I'm a brunette.
I don't know.
Oh, I love brunettes. Anyway, I guess this might be preempted as well. If, you know, tomorrow we could wipe the slate clean and everything gets down to Vanguard's decision as to what we're going to do. If you had if you could have your perfect dream sim, I guess it's going to be the Pacific, but there's no ground troops involved there, so I don't know if you're going to incorporate that. But how would it look and feel if you could have your perfect ideal?
Yeah, I think the theme of this interview is kind of hinted at it. Just a bit. Within an ACG context, yeah, I think it's Guadalcanal. There's enough of every, there's like a massive plethora of missions, and what the history behind all the operations behind it is very varied depending on the different periods that you're looking at it, because they were there from mid 42 all the way to 44. So there's a ton of stuff to look at there. Platform, to be honest, I don't think any platform would do it justice in the way I want it. So I'm honestly quite content to just sit and wait and let hardware develop.
Oh, actually, I know I have to ask. Do you have VR, by the way?
No, just flying on flat screen.
Are you tempted by VR, given the wave of VR in ACG?
Not really. The computer, it's a bit of logistics in terms of, like, I don't want to spend that much on my PC. Like, I wouldn't hesitate to do so, but I use it for work as, like, my work and study as well, so it's a bit of, like, a pleasure, extra pleasure contraption. out of context, it's going to sound really weird.
Pardon?
I think it's really cool. But for my logistics, no. I'm pretty happy with just track IR flat screen. That works for me.
And I guess Vanguard's golden message for anyone that is looking to join ACG would be, well, it's the same as it was back in 2015. You can join with just a keyboard and no clue and get in there.
Yeah, absolutely. I try to hold my own. I try to remember how lost I was when I joined, and I want to I really want ACG to maintain that, where we can bring people into flight simming. I look at us as almost like a club, where there's always going to be a rotation of people coming to flight sim, and we want to help people get interested. You know, stay for the flying. You can develop over time. You make really great friendships in this place, and yeah, there's more to just flying.
Well, thanks for taking the time, Vanguard, and I hope everyone's enjoyed listening to your views and everything you've got to say. And anybody wants to reach out to Vanguard, he's often around, so say hello.
Yeah, absolutely.
Cheers, buddy.
Cheers. Have a good day.